Thank you for coming to spend this beautiful Saturday morning here at Therapro. Whenever I come here, I feel like a kid in a candy store when I'm surrounded by all these great sensory motor materials that I want to touch and feel and rub and manipulate. So feel free when I'm done speaking to explore the store. I will be talking about my new book. I don't know if you can see the red up there, but you know the title. From Rattles to Writing, A Parent's Guide to Hand Skills. It is written primarily with the parent in mind who has a child who is typically developed. But it's also written for parents and families who have children who have learning challenges, because many of the activities in my book can be adapted and make learning easier for all children, and especially children who have some learning challenges. And I will be talking about that in a little while, some of those adaptations. This book is also written for occupational therapists, all therapists, physical therapists, speech therapists, educators, teachers, and other early childhood development professionals, such as Head Start teachers, psychologists as well. And anyone who thinks that this is the way to develop hand skills, because it's not, as my book will very firmly state, that is not the way to develop hand skills. Can you see, or am I blocking you? You can see over there. Okay. And when there are a lot of great benefits to assistive technology and to computers, but not at this age. This age, we really need to focus on developing those sensory motor skills that children need in order to learn how to read and write. When I wrote this book because adaptations can make learning easier for all children. And just as an example, if you look at lacing boards that are typically sold for children who are 3, 4, 5 years old, they're very common activities because they're great for developing eye-hand coordination, but most lacing boards have 20, 25 holes, lots of holes, and that's great for a five-year-old who has pretty good coordination or an older child who's used to lacing boards, but they're not great for first learning. So if you create your own lacing board that has only 3 holes or 4 holes and there are larger holes, then it's easier for children with coordination problems to start out learning how to use a lacing board. So that's a very simple adaptation, and I just cut that out of cardboard and put some duct tape on that particular lacing board to create color contrast. And on the right is just an example of another simple adaptation, angling the writing material. And you can buy wooden, there's lots of great products you can buy that are probably a lot nicer than this one, but you can make a pretty simple easel, table easel, by using a book binder. So I describe that in my book. A bit about myself, and then I'm going to ask a bit about you. I started out, actually before becoming an occupational therapist, I worked with adults with developmental disabilities in group homes. I lived in a group home as a house parent back in the mid to late 1970s, so hopefully you don't realize how old I am, but I did start doing that in the 70s. Then I worked as an OT assistant before going to school in a school in Boston, where I actually met Philomena. She was my first OT supervisor, and she just graduated. So that's how far back we go. And Karen Conrad, the owner of Therapro, was an interim director of that program while the regular director was away doing NDT training. So I know Karen from way back then, so it's pretty exciting to be here today. Since becoming an OT, I've worked in special ed collaboratives, 9 years in the public school system, doing evaluations, working with some of the kids who have special needs in the public schools, and I worked for 5 years at the Hogan Regional Center. While I was at the Hogan Regional Center, which is where I service adults with a variety of functional levels, they all have developmental disabilities, different behavioral issues, I designed many activities for them, which I describe in my book called The Recyclng Occupational Therapist, and that book is actually available to purchase through Therapro if there aren't any here today. So you'd have to go to the website to order the book. About this time when I was working at Hogan, or a little bit before I started working at Hogan, I had a baby, and does my printer work? I forgot how this works. I picture there is about 2 or 3 years old, and he's holding a detergent bottle. Because about that time when he was born, I realized that so many of the toys and activities that are sold, marketed for babies and young children are made out of plastic, and that plastic is very similar to the same plastic I see in detergent bottles that we all throw away. These days we recycle them, but back then they were all being thrown away. And in the bathtub, that may look like a bathtub full of baby toys, but it's not. It's a bathtub full of recycled products. Because I am also a recycling occupational therapist, and I want to show how those baby toys really are very similar to the types of materials, some of the materials that you're actually going to learn about today and that I write about in my book. Therapy involves using the horse as a treatment tool to achieve functional outcomes. And the reason why I'm talking to you about hippotherapy right now is not because I talk about horses in my book. I don't even mention horses in my book. But because that is the type of clinical work I'm doing right now, you're going to see a lot of photographs that involve activities that are great for promoting hand skills. Many of them are in the book, most of them are in my book, but you're going to see them doing them while on a horse. So now you know why all the kids, many of these kids are sitting on a horse. And as an example of some activities that they can do on the horse is a lacing activity, using the cord. Instead of lacing or stringing beads, children who are just learning the concept of stringing or inserting the cord through a large donut shape, it's easier to use thick cord and making a donut shape either by cutting plastic and cutting out a hole. So much easier for learning than using large beads. Or you can slice a shampoo bottle, just slice it, so you end up with that donut shape, a slice of a shampoo bottle. So that makes learning much easier. Then the guy on the right, he has some motor planning issues, and he's not very motivated, he has some attention issues. So I took the squiggly wiggly writer, which I always find a challenge to say, I take the pinpoint out, throw it away, or there might be some other similar motorized toys that you can use, and I put it inside a noodle, and I attach the noodle to, it's inside a holder, and I attach it to the horse, so when that noodle vibrates, that's my ring stack. I make all kinds of ring stacks. And when that noodle vibrates, it helps him focus, it provides that sensory input, and that sound helps him focus as well, and it's fun and it motivates him. And that he actually does quite better using that ring stack, using my adaptation. And that little guy is between 2.5 and 3. He's a little guy. I actually work mostly with little kids, which I love. I have a great deal of fun with. So these are my books, The Recyclng Occupational Therapist, which is going to be changing publishers in the near future, and the new publisher will probably be Therapro. So you may, but Therapro is currently selling the Recyclng Occupational Therapist through the catalog and online. And the book that I self-published, Still Giving Kisses, A Guide to Helping and Enjoying the Alzheimer's Gift and New Love, I wrote during the 8 years when my mother had Alzheimer's, and I found myself adapting activities for her, adapting her environment, and being her advocate. So the book is part memoir and part what it's like to be an OT, as a mother with memory impairment. So I wanted to share that with you, and of course I want to share my new book, which I am so excited about today. My new book, From Rattles to Riding. It covers children from birth through age 5. And the chapters are divided into age groupings, starting with 0 to 3, 3 month periods, 3 to 6, 6 to 12, 3 to 6 months, because children develop so rapidly. I devoted entire chapters to those 3 month periods. Then development is still rapid, but not quite as rapid. So we have a chapter with 6 to 12 months, 12 to 18 months, and 18 to 24 months. And then since the 2 and 3 and 4-year-olds don't develop quite as rapidly, I devoted one chapter to each of those age groupings. And then at the end of the book, I talk about the skills that children need as they approach 5 years of age, and parents are looking at entering kindergarten or homeschooling or whatever their situation or their choice is, What are the skills expected of those children, those 5 and 6 year olds? So I talk about those skills, and the entire book is basically a guide to how to prepare your child from birth for that big, all-important day when we get to say goodbye and watch them get on that school bus. And then we go home and cry. Okay, the book, each chapter has the following sections. Each chapter that focuses on each of those age groupings begins with an introduction that describes typical cognitive, social skills, and communication development. So you get an overview of typical development. Then I go into the sections of visual perceptual development, visual motor perception, sensory motor, and large motor development, small motor development. And then beginning at the chapter that covers 18 months, I start talking about pre-writing skills and the development of what's in the skills involved in pre-writing. But the extra bonus materials that I'm very excited about is that the foreword is written by Lindsay Beal, who wrote a fantastic book, Raising a Sensory Smart Child, which is a huge focus on how to help those children with sensory issues. I have an extensive glossary, so within the book itself, I describe all the terms that parents need to know, and therapists can share these terms with parents because they're explained in layman's terminology, easy to understand. And then in the back of the book is a glossary so they can easily look up each other's terms. I have visual motor scales, so parents can quickly look up what typical development is, what they should expect, those skills related to visual and motor skills, and numerous resources, and I also include an alphabet chart with formation arrows. Now, throughout the entire book, I focus on, we don't want them writing yet. They're not even 5. We don't want them writing yet, but we want to develop the hand strength, the visual, the sensory, the manipulation skills, coordination. It's all about building hand skills. But there will always be those parents who want their kids to write. So if they really insist on teaching them how to form letters before age 5, I wanted to provide the alphabet chart just so they can see how letters are formed correctly, because it's very difficult to learn that. But most of the paper and not so much pencil, but markers and crayons and chalk and other writing utensils that I talk about. Pre-writing activities, I'm not talking about pencils. I'm talking about coloring with your index and using other media, not skinny pencils. Okay, well, I didn't even ask about the audience. I'm going to stop her for a moment because I do want to know, how many of you are occupational therapists? A lot of you are occupational therapists. Okay, great. How many of you are physical therapists? Speech therapists? Psychologists? Social workers? Parents? Parents who, you could be an OT. How about parents who are here primarily because they're interested, who aren't therapists but they're interested because they're parents? So I think one person. Okay, so we're primarily OTs, so that's great. A lot of the material you're going to hear today will not be new, but and
teachers.
Did I leave out teachers? Oh, teachers always get left out. Oh, I'm so sorry. Let's give a hand for teachers. Because teachers are never be left out. Oh, no. It's just documented. I'm okay. I'm going to make sure you are recognized throughout this entire rest of my talk. Okay. We are going to learn about typical development, children 0 to 5. So this is what my book covers. As I said, typical development in all of those areas. Readers will learn, and the book is written primarily for parents who have typically or perhaps children with learning challenges. But as therapists, I think this can be a great assist to use with parents to explain what is scanning, what is figure-ground discrimination, what is the visual perception, and what are those activities that develop those skills. So I think therapists can use this as a teaching guide, especially in early intervention when a big part of our role as OTs is to teach these skills and how to promote these skills. So my book includes information on teaching strategies, forward chaining, backward chaining, hand over hand assistance. I'm going to talk about that in a little while. Readers will learn that learning is sequential. We begin with large muscle control. Babies develop large muscle control before they develop small muscle control. And parents need to learn about those activities that are very simple and cost nothing, such as putting the baby on the chest to develop their shoulder strength. They need to develop shoulder strength before they develop the hand strength, the coordination to sign. That little guy is signing. Babies learn with their eyes before they begin manipulating activities. So parents need to learn that they need to expose their children to those visual activities that develop eye skills, tracking, visual fixation, in preparation for them to, before they learn to reach and grasp and manipulate objects. And that visual skills are sequential. They're going to first focus on materials that are up close and in midline before they develop the skills to scan a greater visual field or a greater distance. Babies use whole body movements before they develop the unilateral movements to reach and manipulate. Children, now this is not in my book, but I have a little theme running through today's presentation, and that theme is from three-dimensional to two-dimensional, from 3D to 2D. Because parents may wonder, what is so important about a ring stack? Okay, it's fun. We see ring stacks in all the stores. But that ring stack is 3D, and it prepares that child for 2D down the road. So they recognize the very same circle that a ring is. A ring is a circle that they are manipulating. He's learning about spatial relationships and fitting that circle on the ring stack. He will need to understand how those circles fit on paper and how eventually those circles fit inside the lines on paper. So we start out with a 3D circle and then we move into that 2D circle. And I love activities that I call transitioning activities from 3D to 2D. The taking that cup and putting it in paint, putting those circles, making those circles on paper. It's a 3D manipulation activity, but we have a 2D circle. So I make up my own lingo, my own terminology, because I like to see if it ever becomes commonplace lingo and terminology. It make me really happy if I find out that all around the world people actually use that lingo and know what I'm talking about. So we will, I will introduce you to some of my personal OT lingo. Another example, stickers are, we manipulate stickers, so they're 3D, but they're flat. Just like form words are flat. So they create a nice transition to learning about circles. So it prepares children for recognizing the circle shape and other shapes. Oops, did I skip one? Okay, using stencils. The child can form a circle shape by coloring inside that 3D stencil and then end up with that 2D circle. And this is a fine motor skill that parents can work on, an activity parents can do years before their child is ever going to be ready to control the pencil and form that circle or fit that circle between the lines. So parents need to understand all of these early fine motor activities that lead to reading and writing. And here we go. ABC, learning to form letters and numbers. My book discusses learning toys to purchase, because by no means do I expect parents to make everything just because I make everything. And there are many great learning toys, many of them are right here in the Therapro store, that are designed to help children learn many of the concepts that I'm talking about today and describe in my book. But there are also many learning toys that parents, they want to make, because when you make your own toys, they could be individualized, they could be adapted. And to tell you the truth, I've never seen anything like that in a store. So some of the toys that I encourage parents to make, they may not be able to find in any other context. So they may want to just pull out some scissors and make some of these products. And you know, I don't think I put in my slideshow presentation today, I don't focus on how to make many of these activities. It's not really the focus, but in my book, I just describe the scissors and the heavy-duty hole puncher and the materials that I use to make a lot of my plastic activities. So it's in my book, and all of this is also on my website, recyclingoc.com. My website has many different names. One of the names, Barbara Smith Occupational Therapist.com, is very long and quite the mouthful that's in the book, but I created some shorter domain names like Recycling OT just to make it easier on the fingers. Okay. Coloring, making a hopscotch board, forming those squares or those rectangles, and then an older child needs to form those squares during the paper and pencil task in school. So it all begins with those 3D materials. I'm going to talk now about adapting activities, some of my adaptations, to promote the motor and perceptual skills. Have any of you heard of I don't see my Velcro bottle. I was going to say, I don't have it with me. I thought I did. Have any of you heard of the Velcro bottle? Okay, no one's heard of the Velcro bottle. This is my own personal lingo. I've been talking about Velcro bottles for over 20 years, so I'm hoping that it becomes part of, you know, enters the dictionary along with texting and sexting and all that stuff. So Velcro bottles, this is a Velcro bottle. You can use a bottle that's just a drinking bottle, any bottle, but I find the ones used for detergents or dishwasher soap work great. And you just put little pieces of hooked Velcro on the bottle, and then you put little pieces of hooked Velcro on your toys. They could be flat toys, such as the letters. They could be more three-dimensional toys. And then children pull them off and put them inside. 18-month-old children, 15 months to 2 years old, are working a lot on stabilizing and insertion, learning how to insert. So you can grade an activity like that. You can have a large opening, and then have a container with a smaller opening. You can have a lot of Velcro, which makes it more challenging to rip them off, and kids love that Velcro sound. Or you can make it easier for success. Use less Velcro, so it's really easy to pull them off and put them in. If you use a detergent bottle with a smaller opening and you don't cut the top away, you can have the cover be used for storage, and it just makes a great storage container. Just screw the cap off. Okay, another adaptation, I talked earlier about a lacing board, and this lacing board I actually remembered to bring along, so you can see an adaptive lacing board. And this is really fast. I just cut out a piece of cardboard, cut out the circles, you can add a picture, you don't have to, and you have a lacing board that a toddler can use. That lacing board, your 3 or 4 year old or 5 year old can use the lacing boards that have many, many holes. But a toddler can learn on this lacing board. Okay, so parents need to provide those toys and activities that promote stabilizing with one hand and manipulating with the other hand. Mr. Potato Head is wonderful. And the shape sorter that you've all seen that is marketed for 1 to 2 year olds to learn the basic shapes is great. But I made it a Velcro shape sorter so that I would be sure that they would have to stabilize it while pulling it off, because somehow children manage to do things with one hand. I don't know how, but when they don't want to use both hands, they find a way. So my goal is to find ways to prevent that, to make it so that they really need to use both hands. So they need to stabilize that shape sorter to pull the shapes off and put them inside. And then, to make it even more exciting and fun, I put a motor inside sometimes. Some kids don't like the motor. So it's all trial and error. What does your child like? Some children love the motor. You're going to see in a video a bit later. You can put a motor inside that container, such as the squiggly wriggly writer motor. Take the pinpoint out. You could put the motor to an electric toothbrush inside, and that whole thing vibrates. And it's just really a lot of fun for a two-year-old to do that. Plastic, it's larger than a button, and I have found that when it's flat, it's actually easier to use than a button that's not completely flat. Then I cut a half with a slit, and you can make that opening as large as you need to. It makes buttoning really, really easy. And they can do several in a row. When teaching a skill such as this, I generally teach how to take apart. It's easier to take apart than to put together. So you're usually going to teach them how to take apart. And that goes the same for taking apart screw caps and taking apart knots. Taking apart anything is usually easier. So that's a good way to introduce children to a fine motor activity, especially when it's this complex, take it apart. But I have another adaptation. I have it in this picture. I just took a piece of cardboard, I covered it with fabric. I don't think this is not in the book, but this is in one of my books, but you're learning it here today. I just sewed these so-called buttons, and you can put these fabric pieces on all of them and have them remove all six. So they can work on sequencing left to right, they can work on task completion, but most importantly at all, it's developing the skills that will help them to manipulate buttons. So as OTs, oh sure, I will pass these around. As OTs and teachers, because we know teachers are very important, and everybody else who might be here today, we know that we want to provide materials that develop the fine motor skills that enable our children to perform their functional tasks. So it may not seem that functional to be opening and closing those button squares, but that will help them perform a functional task to get dressed. So here's another, he's kind of part of the OT lingo and teacher lingo in this world. So he's very easy to make. Rubber band balls are great for developing hand skills. Taking paper and putting it on top of a raised surface for embossing, just rubbing. What I like about this is she is just taking the crayon, rub, 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 rub. She's strengthening those fingers. It would be better if there's no vertical. I apologize. It's not on a vertical surface. But she's not forming letters. She's not even forming lines. She's just coloring. She's focused on just covering that she's seeing the pictures that magically appear on the paper. So it's just a simple, straightforward hand strengthening activity without the added stress of dealing with forming letters or forming shapes. Sparklers are great for promoting separation of the thumb from the rest of the hand, so it helps promote that opposition that children need for using scissors and for forming the tripod. The light bright games, similar games, are great for tripod fingers, and of course we love clothespins, and we love anything that resembles a clothespin because we OTs and teachers, I hope you love, do teachers love clothespins?
Absolutely.
Teachers love clothespins, yes. Teachers are wonderful, they love clothespins just like the OTs do. And you can incorporate the clothespins in color matching, lots and lots of different ways to use clothespins. I love looking at new and exciting ways to incorporate clothespins. Sensory input, so I wanted to share with you ring stack and cone stack activity. I discovered that these massagers fit right inside, so I sewed one of these green cone stack cones to this fabric. It's a long fabric snake that you put under the door to keep the cold out. And I sewed this to it, and then I sew one end to the snake. Then I put this right underneath, and I have children stack the cones. And we actually do this while they're on the horse. It's a lot of fun. It works on course in midline, the way I position it. They generally use both hands. It's hard to do with one hand. And then when they put the cone on, if they don't push hard enough, I help them to make it vibrate. So I'm going to pass. Let me show you the other one first, the other vibration. I had a little boy with cerebral palsy who needed something strong to stabilize his hands on, and I don't know why, but I came up with this plunger idea. And it's brand new. I put some nice pretty stickers on it, and I colored it blue, so hopefully it doesn't quite look like a plunger. And then I discovered that this fits inside, so I could have children stack shapes, and then I can help them press down and be rewarded with vibration. So it's amazing when you add a sensory component to something, how it will motivate a child to who is challenged to pay attention and engage in hand skills. So I'm going to pass both of these around. And I think they would be fun for any child to use, but they're particularly effective working with children who have attention issues. Yes?
What may be the vibration?
The vibration?
Yeah.
The massager that's going...
Just that little tactile piece or something like that?
The green piece is the massager.
Oh, it vibrates.
It vibrates,
it
yeah.
It vibrates itself. Oh.
That's the massager. That it vibrates.
Oh.
That entire green piece that I'm holding in the picture,
yeah.
It vibrates. So I think it's sold for, you know, for your sore muscles.
Okay.
It's a massager. So there's so many great different massage items on the market. I use a lot of different ones in different activities.